performed last August in New York City at Lincoln Center for a tribute to Laura Nyro, who's, you know, my main songwriting influence and idol. And also my son is named after her, Nyro, N-Y-R-O. And we sang a couple of songs that were extremely difficult. It was fun because we all stayed in my New York apartment and we rehearsed day and night for a week. It was almost like we were the band again. Yes. And then, you know, it was fun, but also we realized, oh my God, and now I know why we broke up too. That was a big mistake in my life. I should never have broken up my band. That was a huge mistake. No band that ever makes it famous should ever break up for any reason. People can do all of their solo practices as much as they want, but they should always keep the spirit of their band together, and every few years or whatever it is, they should get together, tour again, sing the oldies, sing their individual solo songs within the show, and make people happy. You know, we always keep threatening to do it. It's just that everybody is so busy with their lives. It's just so crazy. We've been talking about this for 20 years, you know. So, and then we get together, we do a few songs, and then, you know, we have some songs in the can. We have some songs that we, you know, but you know, I would love to do a movie about our times in New York. I think if we had a movie, then we could sing all the songs for the movie, and then there'd be interest in our story. And also, I've been very slowly writing my autobiography. Okay. And I wanted to write a book that would be inspiring to our songwriters. Mm-hmm. And then I realized that couldn't be my autobiography. Mm-hmm. I had to write two books. Yeah. One that was inspiring and one that was my real true story. Mm-hmm. You know, truthfully, I haven't listened to the whole album. Mm-hmm. And I haven't even listened to my song. Isn't that crazy? because I wanted to listen to it properly and sit down and really listen to it and not just listen to it in the background. And since I started the Latin Songwriters Hall of Fame, I have been, every moment has been working on that. And so I haven't had a relaxed moment to actually concentrate on it. So, I mean, I want to do it justice. So that's why I'm waiting. That sounds like a terrible thing to say, but in a way, it's the most respectful thing I could say. Well, you know, every producer and songwriter, they try and try and try because there are new artists that come along and you think they're going to be the biggest thing, you hope they'll be the biggest thing, and then, you know, sometimes they, you know, that happened to me with a girl that I met about 8 years ago, 7 years ago, named Katy Perry. Mm-hmm. She was a girl that was singing in a group. She was the lead singer of The Matrix. And then she was on Columbia Records, and then we wrote a song called Waking Up in Vegas. And then she got dropped from the label. And then a long time went by, and I didn't know what was going to happen with her. And all of a sudden, she surfaces. And all of a sudden, Waking Up in Vegas is number one with Katy Perry. That was a long journey. That took, since the day we wrote the song, that took 3-4 years to happen. So you never know who's going to make it and who's not. But she is such a beautiful woman and such a talented artist that there was no stopping her, and very determined. It's kind of a crazy question because music has changed so much and the market's changed so much. And, you know, at that time, the album before mine that Alice Cooper did sold like almost nothing. And so, you know, I don't think he had been being produced properly before I came into the picture. And so I think that then, you know, our album sold millions, and, you know, it was very, very successful. But then, you know, because of whatever reasons, they didn't hire me, he didn't hire me to do the next record, and then he left the label. So I don't know what to say. I brought all of my contacts into that record, Bon Jovi, Aerosmith, Joan Jett, to help write and sing songs, and they were the top people of the time. So I brought all of my contacts to bear to show that Alice Cooper was still very viable and vibrant, and he and I co-wrote those songs. It was a magical experience writing those songs, because he explained how Alice Cooper is a character, like a character in a musical. And so that was made it very easy to write for the character, as opposed to, you know, a person whose real feelings and real thoughts and real, you know, life had to be in the song. It was all a fantastic creative fantasy. And that's where the real Alice Cooper lives, in that world between the listener and the man who creates the illusion that is Alice Cooper. John Bon Jovi, that's the secret.
Not John Bon Jovi and Richie Sambora together.
Listen, Richie and John are an amazing team, but it's John's drive, the vision, that makes the whole thing work. Because, you know, Richie's an artist. You know, John Bon Jovi is a businessman and a visionary, an entrepreneur. He's a philanthropist. He's a songwriter, he's a singer, he's one of the greatest entertainers of all time. Every great genre of music needs to have a groundbreaking star. And he was it. For his generation, he continues for two more generations after that. It's been fantastic to ride the golden chariot that he is driving. Been very close with Gene for the first time for the last couple of years, and he's become actually a mentor of mine and advising me in different things. And I've written for his band, The Envy, from Canada, and so we're collaborating together for the first time, and I admire him very much. I think that he was used to saying controversial things. And so I think that was really a part of it. And I just happened to be someone he picked on, because I was collaborating with Bon Jovi and Aerosmith and having number one songs. And so then they decided to make an album and do the opposite. And they said, oh, we're not using co-writers like those other bands. We're writing all our own music. And in fact, we have guards in front of the studio doors keeping Desmond Child out. Actually, think about it, it was a compliment. It was a compliment then, but it really was a compliment, because it kind of said, well, I was kind of so important, you know, that you have to keep, you know, armed guards, you know, keep me out of studios. So actually, now looking back on it, I can laugh. Slippery When Wet. I have four songs on Slippery When Wet. And on those songs was pretty much the best song I ever wrote in my entire life, called Living on a Prayer. And I heard it last night, you know, that John waits to the end of the show to finally do the song. And people went crazy. They were screaming it, an entire arena. They're screaming every word of the song. And it was so exciting. I mean, it was incredible. I was so, you know, proud and happy that I feel like I wrote more, you know, and John and I discussed this. We feel like we wrote more than a song. We wrote kind of an event. The song is an event, because it has pulled together so many people, and has gotten letters all these years that people stopped themselves from jumping off a bridge because the song came on the radio in the car that was on the side of the road. They got back in the car. I mean, we've gotten more than you know, one letter like that, and many letters of people making it through hard times or cancer, or, you know, and that song's the song that kept them going. So I think it was a very inspired song, and that really came down from the universe to spread some hope to the world, and we were kind of the channels for it. Mm-hmm. I really do believe that if you listen to that song, it's otherworldly. It's more than a song.